Hi, I'm John Sluter. I'm your Bible friend from Berdoo. This is the fifth part of a series on King Saul of ancient Israel. This part is going to focus on the prophet Shemuel. Shemuel is a giant of the Hebrew Bible. He's important to an understanding of King Saul because it was through Shemuel that God selected Saul. Shemuel anointed Saul, and Shemuel gave guidance to Saul for many years until they had their rift. We're going to discuss three things now. There's largely silence about what it was like for Shemuel to grow up in the house of Eli. We're going to try to penetrate that silence. There's largely silence in Scripture about why there was a 20-year gap between the fall of the house of Eli and the return of the Ark of Moses to the Israelites on one hand, and on the other hand, when Shemuel fully undertakes the mantle of leadership of the Israelites. The third thing we're going to discuss is, what was it that uniquely prepared Shemuel to lead the ancient Israelites at that time and place? So, let's start out by examining what life was like for young Shemuel as he was growing up as the servant of Eli. It's something that the compact narrative of 1 Shemuel doesn't address very much. So we're going to use our imaginations. I approach this task by looking at other stories in the Hebrew Bible that may give some indication about what life was like for young Shemuel. I think about Genesis. I think about the story of the fall of Adam and Eve. I think about the story of Cain and Abel. And both of those stories are about how someone or something was deeply envious and did everything they could to destroy their enemy or ruin their lives. Likewise, in 1 Shemuel, you can read about Hannah and Peninnah and Elkanah, and how Peninnah was driven by envy toward her more attractive co-wife, Hannah, and that caused her to torment poor Hannah until finally she went to the temple, made an oath, and was delivered of a son. I don't think, although I could be wrong, I don't think that Eli was driven by envy in his relationship with Shemuel, once it became clear that Shemuel was visited by God and that God was speaking to him and people were coming to Shemuel, as the scripture says, and the word of God was percolating out through Israel, through Samuel. I don't think that Eli was all that envious, because I suspect that as time went by, he had a deep affection for his young servant, Shemuel, and that might have mitigated some of the envy that he otherwise would have felt, but I think it's a different story with Eli's sons, Hophni and Phinehas. They were corrupt. And it's easy to believe that somebody as corrupt, or some people as corrupt as they were, would be envious of somebody whom God favored, because I think that corruption can make a person, especially a person in a godly occupation, it can make them insecure in their position. So it's not hard to imagine that Hophni and Phinehas were envious of Samuel. It's not hard to imagine ways that their envy might have manifested itself. Simple rudeness, dismissiveness, interference with Shemuel as he did his everyday chores, thinking about ways to make it harder, treating him imperiously. And what might have been most wounding to young Shemuel would be if they were persistent liars and spread ill reports about him. It's not hard to believe that these priests, Hophni and Phinehas, may even have appropriated things that they had heard that young Shemuel had said, and then repeated them, claiming them to be their own inspiration, and then falsely claimed that it was Shemuel who was a liar and warned people that this was a unfaithful, faithless upstart servant who had heirs of greatness, but in fact had none. I think we're all familiar with stories of politicians who accuse their opponents of the very thing that they're guilty of. If they're liars, they call their opponent a liar. If they're corrupt, they call their opponent corrupt. Nobody could really blame the people for being taken in by. Hophni and Phinehas. They had all of the accoutrements of holiness. They had the literal anointing. They had the appearances, the vestments, the position, the place. So for many people, it's fairly automatic to assume the truthfulness of the person in the high position. But there's a strong contrary biblical tradition, and it honors servants. For example, in 1 Kings chapter 5, there's a general named Naaman. He's an Aramean. He has leprosy. The Aramean doctors can't cure him. He doesn't know what to do. He has a servant. She's a slave. She was captured in Israel. She tells the general that there is a prophet in Israel named Elisha, and that she thinks that Elisha may be able to help him. The general is desperate. He puts together a caravan and makes his way to Elisha's doorstep. Elisha sends a messenger out. And the message that he sends is, wash in the Jordan River 7 times and you will be healed. The general is outraged because he was expecting something much more elaborate than simply an admonition to wash. But another servant spoke up. The servant said, look, if this prophet had told you to do something difficult, you would have done it. So, do the easy thing. See what happens. And that's what the general did. And he was cured. I think most Christians know the story of the wedding at Cana. Excuse me, the wedding at Cana. And it's the story of wine running out at a wedding. Jesus was present. His mother importunes him to do something, and he does. He takes jars, he has servants fill them with water, and he turns the water into wine. He tells the servants to take the wine to the chief steward. The steward tastes it. He has no idea where this marvelous wine came from. And then there's this wonderful, it almost seems like a throwaway line. And that line is, but the servants knew. And that brings us back to Samuel, the servant. You might almost call him a suffering servant. But as difficult as one may assume that his young life was, he was also consoled. He was consoled by two things. He was consoled by what I assume was a close relationship with the master, the earthly master he served, namely Eli. I think Eli was fond of him and protected him. And certainly he was consoled by the fact that God came to him, spoke to him, and worked through him. After the house of Eli fell, and after the Ark of Moses, which the Philistines had seized, was returned to the Israelites, still, it took about 20 years for Samuel, or Shemuel, however you want to pronounce it, took on the mantle fully of leadership of the Israelites. And let's spend a little bit of time thinking about why it took 20 years. And there are two components to that. One is the preparation of the people of Israel, and the other is the preparation of Shemuel. One of the reasons that it might have taken 20 years before Shemuel could ascend to the leadership of Israel was, or is related to something that we were talking about just a few minutes ago. Namely, that it may be that Phinehas and Hophni stigmatized Shemuel by burying him under their tall tales in order to gain credit that they didn't earn by burying the person who deserved it. 20 years is enough time for one generation to pass away and for another one to come to maturity. And after 20 years, people who were, as it were, the opinion leaders in Israel may no longer have been the people who grew up hearing these vague or precise tales of this whacked out servant who thought he was something when he was nothing. Also, new ideas sometimes permeate slowly through a society. And it may have taken 20 years before the people of Israel were finally willing to try a new thing. They were syncretic at first. It made sense to them to worship many gods because you never knew which one was the one true God, or maybe all of them working in tandem might help you succeed in ways that one God alone would not. And it's not an idea that they gave up quickly. After 20 years of additional painful subjugation by the Philistines, maybe finally they were ready. Also, it may have taken 20 years for Samuel himself to become mature in the Lord sufficiently that he was ready to lead, not only able to hear God as much as he needed to undertake the responsibility of leading God's people, but it also might have taken that much time for him to be able to undertake that responsibility without getting a swelled head about it. And this is a way in which this discussion of the 20 years that it took before Shemuel undertook the leadership role dovetails with the issue of what it was that set Shemuel apart from the generation that he was born into that made him capable of leadership. 20 years might have been necessary for God to drip, drip, drip his own spirit into Shemuel's until Shemuel got both the humility and confidence through the Spirit of God to lead the people of Israel. In Proverbs, there is a proverb that says, what is quickly gained is soon lost. Maybe you can talk to somebody who won the lottery and within a year declared bankruptcy about whether that's true. Maybe you can talk to somebody who married in haste and divorced in haste. But it seems to be true about spirituality too. There seems not to be a quick and easy way. It just takes time. It takes time to come to full maturity. Great progress can be made immediately, and a person can be a different person quickly. But for the person to come to full maturity, for the spirituality to mellow, takes time. So there's that issue having to do with why it may have taken 20 years before Shemuel was ready. What else set Shemuel apart? Certainly, even before he was afflicted by Phinehas and Hophni, he was in pain. Even before he was capable of understanding what that pain was or where it came from, when he was weaned, he was turned over and made the servant of a stranger. The close, constant relationship that he had with his loving mother was broken. And for a child that young, I don't think any explanation can get it into his head what happened to him, and certainly it could not console him. He longed for his mother. He was pained by her absence. And it's just possible that he interpreted what had happened to him as a punishment.
A child who grows up being subject to harsh discipline on a routine basis tends to internalize the value system of the person imposing that discipline. That can be a good thing. It can be a bad thing. A bad thing if the person who is afflicting them is a person of low morals. But if their disciplinarian, by some stroke of good fortune, has a high degree of virtue, it can be something of a boon.
The example from history that I think of is John Brown, the man who attacked Harper's Ferry and lit the fuse on the Civil War. He was dealt with severely by his father, and his father was a strict Calvinist. That made John Brown a deeply good and a deeply unusual man. He understood in a very deep way the evil that slavery was. He also understood, when most people did not, that it would take violence to overthrow the slavery empire. And he himself went happily to his death, believing that he had set in motion a course of events that would lead to the end of slavery. I think that young Shemuel was in deep pain. It made him very receptive to the teaching of his master and his mentor, who was the priest Eli. And it put him, morally, head and shoulders above anybody else of his generation. The constant harassment that I imagine that Shemuel suffered from Eli and Hophni also contributed. On top of the pain that he had from the loss of his mother, I think it inculcated in him the importance of being a good servant. And he was so invested with the habits of a servant, I think that he never lost them. And finally, just being a servant and having the spirit of a servant inculcated in him so deeply, in a man who is also being groomed for leadership, made him unique in his generation and perhaps in almost any generation.
Our time is drawing to a close. Let's review. We've talked a little bit about Phinehas and Hophni, how they might have affected Samuel as he was growing up. There are so many questions about Phinehas and Hophni that we just don't know the answers to. For example, we don't know the particulars of how they died. Did they die as they had lived? Or, in dying, were they able to reach into the Spirit of God, which perhaps never entirely left them? Were they able to summon up courage, boldness, unselfishness, so that they died defending the Ark of Moses with their last breath and with the last of their strength? We're unlikely to know the answer to that question on this side of eternity. As to Samuel, we've discussed what it was like for him to grow up in the house of Eli. We've talked about the 20-year gap in the narrative, and we've talked about what it was, what conditions existed that might have contributed to his capability as a leader 20 years on. there are some aspects of his upbringing that we have almost no information on. For example, we know he became a capable military leader, and we know that he was, at least at some point in his life, hands-on. We come in the narrative eventually to a point where he takes a sword and cuts down a man as ruthlessly as a starving man cuts into a pancake. If you've never killed before, killing another human being is not an easy thing. How did Samuel grow into being a capable military leader? We just don't know. There are all kinds of possibilities. Maybe he was like Oliver Cromwell. Oliver Cromwell was a natural military genius. Maybe he was like Arminius. Arminius rose in the ranks of the Roman Empire in its military, and then he left. He used his acquired skills and knowledge to destroy 3 Roman legions. Maybe Samuel somehow was like that. Maybe Samuel started out small hit-and-run raids against the Philistines, and simply step by step by step over the years became a man capable of leading an army against another army and winning. Maybe it is simply the case that God ordained him to win, and so he did. We just don't know, or maybe it's more correct to say that I don't know. And one more thing about Samuel and his upbringing and his consolations. He had the consolation of his closeness to God. He had the consolation of what I think was a close relationship with his master, Eli. I think there was another consolation. His family, his mother, visited him every year. It must have been a profoundly joyful time, however brief it was. It's interesting that at the beginning of 1 Samuel, we find out that Samuel's mother Hannah, that journey, that pilgrimage to Shiloh, was the time when she was tormented about her childless state. Now, a number of years on, it is the most joyful time for Samuel, maybe the most joyful time for his mother Hannah as well. One wonders if Samuel learned to tamp down his elation, his excitement, when his family came. The reason I wonder that is because the visits were necessarily brief, and it must have been intensely painful again when they parted as they had to. And one must wonder whether Samuel made a bargain with his heart. He would not be as delighted when they came if only he was not so terribly lonely and terribly sad when they left. But it's time to leave these issues because we're going to move on to the next, to the main event. We're going to, in the next segment, talk about King Saul.